Hi.
If you're looking for methods to validate your CRISPR-Cas9 experiment, so if you're looking to see what kind of edits CRISPR-Cas9 did in your cells, let's take a look at the methods that you can use. Following Cas9-mediated double-stranded DNA break in a target region of the genome, a eukaryotic cell will attempt to repair the break. There are several mechanisms that the cell may use to repair the break, but there are two main repair pathways. One of the two main pathways, repair via homology-directed pathway, depends on the cell searching the DNA for a homologous template to use. The other pathway is known as the non-homologous end joining, and it's more of a panic response and sees the cell shoving the two broken ends together. In so doing, it can create insertions or deletions, particularly where Cas9 is present and keeps cutting the template. So if the cell fixes it perfectly, Cas9 will go back and cut it. And this is why it can create insertions or deletions as the cell tries to fit the two ends back together. If you get insertions or deletions, this can lead to frame shifts in the open reading frame of the transcript. And this will cause premature termination of a messenger RNA transcript. Normally, there are codons that specify the end of a transcript. So just a reminder, you can have TGA or TAA or TAG. And where you have a frame shift mutation due to insertions or deletions, you may come across this stop codon earlier than should be the case. So in the instance where there's a frame shift mutation, so an insertion or deletion for both copies of a gene, that gene is said to be knocked out. But don't forget that in humans or in diploid organisms like ourselves, there are always two copies of a gene. And these are, you inherit one from the parent, from each parent, one from the mom, one from the dad. So there are always two copies. So where you have both of these copies having insertions or deletions due to Cas9 editing, then that gene is said to be knocked out. So in targeting any gene of a diploid organism, there are four possible outcomes. You may have only one of the alleles, so only one of the two alleles being edited. Or you may have both alleles edited with the same mutation. Or you may have both alleles edited, but each allele has a different mutation. Or you may not have an edit at all if Cas9 was not able to be guided by the guide RNA and do the edits. You really want to have both alleles edited in order to be sure that the gene of interest is knocked out. After Cas9 editing, you do need to check if you have had both alleles edited. Where you have both alleles edited and it's the same mutation, this is called a homozygous mutation. But where you have both alleles edited but different mutations, they're known as biallelic mutations. So you want to screen a polyclonal population of cells, if you have used cells, to check that they have a homozygous or biallelic mutation. So here are several strategies you can do for screening the cells to see that they have a homozygous or biallelic mutation. Keep in mind, in either strategy that we're about to look at, that I'm about to present, you will first PCR amplify the region that you targeted. You'll go ahead and extract genomic DNA from the cell or the tissue, and you will then PCR amplify the region that you targeted. Strategy one, after cleaning up your PCR products, you can use either a mismatch cleavage assay, so that's one way of screening, or you can use Sanger Amplicon sequencing, or the third option is to use next generation sequencing. Let's look at each of these in more details. The mismatch cleavage assay. This assay involves you using a nuclease that only cuts when the two strands of DNA are not a match. Normally, the two strands of DNA will be a match. So A will pair with T, T will pair with A, you know, on the opposite strands. There are nucleases that where these strands are not a match, they will cut. One nuclease that does such a job is called a surveyor nuclease, and the other is T7E1 nuclease. So to use these nucleases in the assay, you will first denature the PCR products, then re-anneal. As the DNA re-anneals, some edited strands will pair with unedited strands and you will have a mismatch. The specialized nucleases, surveyor or T7E1, will cleave only such strands that are a mismatch. So when you run this on an agarose gel, you will see multiple bands where editing took place. And this will flag to you that editing has occurred. Mind you, you don't know what kind of edit took place. Was it an insertion? Was it a deletion? This is not going to tell you. But it does tell you that Cas9 has done something and you have got editing, and therefore you can proceed to step two. But before we get to step two, this is the other strategy you can use to see if editing has occurred, and that is the Amplicon sequencing via Sanger sequencing. So Amplicon sequencing will also, you have your PCR product that amplifies the region of interest, and then you can submit those sequencing to a sequencing facility to do Sanger sequencing on. Mind you, this is not quantitative, and you will also not get information about whether you have insertions or deletions, known as indels. And this is because when you submit your polyclonal population, you will have some cells that have not been edited, as I pointed out. And then you will have some that are heterozygous, so they have only one allele that's been edited. And then you have those that have homozygous. So once you sequence these, you're going to have all the different sequences overlapping, and you won't really be able to get the details of that. But once again, just like in the T7E1 or surveyor nuclease assay, it will be an indication that editing has occurred and you can move on to step two. But before we get to step two, there is also the option of checking out your edits in the polyclonal population via Amplicon sequencing using next generation sequencing. So next generation sequencing, you will submit your PCR amplified region to be sequenced. Now, this is very sensitive. It is quantitative. You're going to be able to look at each individual read. And so it will provide you with the sequences and you can tell whether you've had insertions or deletions. The drawback is it's very expensive and you're probably not going to want to use it at this point of just working out if there's an edit. Okay, so now you've used either of those three strategies to determine that you have an edit, then step two is to create a monoclonal population by serially diluting the cells. And the point of doing this, once again, is so that when you sequence it, you'll be able to tell which clones have biallelic or homozygous mutations. And so you'll be able to identify cells with mutations that resulted in frameshifts in the open reading frame of the messenger RNA transcript. At this point, you really don't want to waste your time with a surveyor or T7E1 nuclease assay because you need details. You need sequence information, so you can use Sanger or you can use next generation sequencing. Remember I said earlier that with the Sanger sequencing, you really don't get information where it's a polyclonal population because some will be wild type sequences, some will be heterozygous, so only one allele got edited, and the others will have the homozygous allele. Well, when you come to this point, where it's a monoclonal population. So for your monoclonal screening, you're going to PCR amplify the targeted region as you did for the polyclonal screening. But this time you're going to clone the amplicons that you get from the PCR into a vector. You do this so that you will have each vector containing only one gene. And in this way, when you get your read back from the Sanger sequencing, you will have a clean trace instead of the overlapping traces. So how do you interpret this result? Well, a gene is considered to be knocked out if all the sequences show frameshift mutations. Once again, for monoclonal, for next generation sequencing, you can just submit the sequences of each of the monoclonals so you can really identify which cells, which clones had a frameshift result from an insertion or a deletion. So that's where at the molecular level, you can work out what edits have taken place. And of course, you go on and do your functional studies using an appropriate assay of choice. These have been just three examples of three strategies that you can use to validate your CRISPR-Cas9 experience, but there are heaps more that have not been covered. So in the description box of this video, I've linked a Nature, a 2018 Nature paper that surveys validation strategies for CRISPR-Cas9. So take a look. These strategies are not the only strategies for validating CRISPR edits. What strategies have you used? I invite you to share what strategies you may have used to validate your CRISPR edits in the comments. And as usual, all the best with your experiments.